Stay tuned for the Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's interview with the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Waiting to be profiled are two actresses. One in the beginning of her career, Angela Sarafyan, and one in the prime of her career, Estelle Parsons. Actress Angela Sarafyan was born in Armenia and came to Hollywood at the age of four. She's in the same home where she started school in America. After high school, Angela attended Pasadena City College but dropped out to seriously pursue her career in acting. She's a rising star whose credits include The Informers, based on Bret Easton Ellis's novel, and on the Doll, and also Kablooey. And you've seen her on TV, where she's had a recurring role on 24, and she's a series regular on ABC's, what is it, Paranormal Girl?
Well, yes, but that was a while ago.
Was it? But you started pretty rapidly. Was it hard to get an agent and to get into these roles?
Well, I started doing extra work, and the first job I got an extra job on a commercial, a Coke commercial.
Oh, I was wondering about the commercials.
And I was upgraded from that commercial, so that's how I got my SAG card. That was like my first extra job.
And how do you become an extra? You just read about it and go on?
My mom, she did some research on finding a kid's background talent agency.
And how old were you then?
I was 16.
Oh, so you were just still a teenager.
I was, yes. And
Or still.
No, I'm not.
No more?
Not anymore. But I was fairly young, and I got upgraded from that commercial, got my SAG card, and then found an agent.
Did you come from a showbiz background?
Well, my father's an actor.
So he is an actor. Was he an actor in Armenia?
He was an actor in Armenia, yes. And he did a few films there. And I didn't know when I wanted to pursue acting that he was an actor himself.
But you didn't realize it?
Well, my desire for acting wasn't because he did it. It was very early on. I was a little girl. I love fantasies and stories and to tell stories. So that's how it started.
But you dropped out of school. Did you know what you wanted to do?
Out of college.
Yeah. Why? How did you decide that you knew that?
Well, I knew that I grew up on stage dancing ballet, and I played the piano, you know, what is it called? Oh, I can't think of it. Classically, I'm classically trained. So I grew up doing all these arts, and I just knew that acting was something that I wanted to pursue.
And how did you find an acting teacher? Because you said you really went to work with one of the top teachers here and in London, I think.
Well,
is he in London?
His name is Tony Greco, and he teaches in Los Angeles and New York. He's taught in London, is teaching in Japan at some point in the year. And the kind of acting he teaches is method. That's the technique. So when you mentioned Estelle Parsons, that's the world that this teacher comes from. And it's from Lee Strasberg and the Stanislavski method that he continues.
But how did you find him? How did you know that's what you wanted to do? And how did he take you as a young person?
Well, I was really young when I started that class, a little too young. I think I was 19 when I started that class, and most of the people in that class were in their 30s or mid-20s. And I was searching for an acting teacher, and my grandmother said, come watch Ellen DeGeneres. And I was like, oh, no, I'm looking for an acting teacher, Grandma. And she's like, no, come watch Ellen DeGeneres. And so I came and watched, and Amy Smart, who was a student of his at the time, mentioned Tony Greco. And I thought, okay, great, I'm going to look for Tony Greco on the internet, found his phone number, called him, and he said, "Where'd you get this number?" I said, "On the internet," because it was his home number.
Oh, what?
Yeah, yeah. So then after we spoke, I started class in about a week.
Did you?
He teaches three times out of the year in Los Angeles. So that was February of the, and it's for a month. And I'm in class now. I'm in class now with him.
Then you shot it, did commercials, mm-hmm. and you said, did you ever work on stage singing and dancing?
Yes.
You did do
yes.
that. And you made a short film in Florida called, what was it, Velvet?
Yes.
And what was that short film supposed to do? Do they think about going on to making a feature-length film, or why?
Oh, I'll tell you. So they'd made two other short films. They're black and white, and they're mainly about relationships. And this particular one is about a guy and a girl who are in love, and she's an actress, and things are all very good, but she's unhappy. She's really unhappy with he wants to have sex all the time, and she doesn't want just sex. So you see the story start from her wanting to break, just unhappy, and at the end they break up.
And then could that then, how many minutes was that?
Well, should be about 10 minutes.
Oh, it's a very short
film. It's a very short film.
So would that director try to expand it?
Well, yes, they're talking about doing a possibly an HBO series type of thing. They're not very clear.
So, but the point I'm getting at is, why do they make these short films? So there's all different reasons, I guess. TV, a series.
Well, yes. He actually, the very first one he did, it's called A Relationship in 4 Days, won Sundance and Cannes.
Oh, see, so there you
go. So he has a very specific style. It's actually, I'm a fan of his
Who
work.
Who is it?
His name is Peter Glanz.
G-L-E-N-N?
G-L-A-N-Z.
Oh, Glanz.
Yeah.
Well, talking about directors, uh-huh. the film that is, you're on the screen, in almost every scene, aren't
you? Have you seen that film?
Yes. It's A Beautiful Life.
Yes.
And it's Alejandro Chomsky.
Yes.
And is he Argentinian?
Yes. Yes, he is.
And he just has you just wandering because you're a runaway.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about the story.
Well, Maggie is a girl who runs away from home and tries to find her way on her own, but she's 15 or 16. Well, she's 15 when all this happens. So you see her journey from the beginning of the film till the end,
mm-hmm.
and what she goes through, where she's going to live, how she's going to make money, the people that she meets in the process.
It's really fantastic. And you work with a group of really great actors. Bai Ling is fantastic, isn't
yes,
she? And she Jesse
is.
Garcia.
Yes.
And is it like an ensemble?
Yes,
in a way, it's
it is.
Like an ensemble cast. Did you all bond?
Well, you know, it was shot in only 17 days.
Where was it shot?
Downtown Los Angeles. So
I saw some of the buildings
yeah.
from downtown, but she runs away from New Jersey, I thought.
No.
Oh, she runs away here.
Yes, she runs away here. She takes the bus
and
comes down.
I see.
And we didn't have that much time to bond, but the moments that we had together, because it's interesting, the story, she meets these people, so they're not necessarily the friends from the past.
No, they're none of her friends. Does she come from a well-to-do family?
She comes from a middle-class family.
Dana Delany is?
Is my mother.
Is your mother, and I thought Debbie Mazur, what a turnabout,
yeah.
as the librarian.
Yes.
She's not her kind of a role.
Not at all. And she was really very charismatic and very sweet and lovely to work with.
And I did see Jesse Garcia in Quinceañera, which was
yes.
another independent film. And it was shot in L.A.
It was shot in Silver Lake, yes.
Was it near where you were?
No, that was further east. We were hard in the heart of downtown.
And what was the really... the style of Alejandro Chomsky.
His style in
of directing.
Directing. He's very involved. He likes to make sure that you're comfortable to do whatever you'd like. And he is clear about what he wants. So it's good to have a director that knows what he wants and directs you in the way that he wants you to get there.
And did he cast you?
Yes.
He must have, because he knew you were going to be on the screen.
Yes.
The whole time.
Right. Well, how it happened is I met Deborah, who wrote the script. And after we spoke about the script, I auditioned. And then I met the director, and Alejandro and Deborah. Then had another reading with Jesse Garcia.
That was fantastic. What's up on your schedule coming up?
Well, a few movies are coming out, and currently going to go work on Eastwick, which is going to be fun. I look forward to it. Been looking for work and getting some work, so I've been very fortunate, I feel.
We're going to watch your career, because I think as someone who can take over a film the way you took it over and won us as an audience in A Beautiful Life has to be watched.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Angela.
Thank you.
And don't go away. We'll be right back with Estelle Parsons. Hi, welcome back to the Joan Quinn Profiles, and I'm Joan Quinn. I'm here with actress Estelle Parsons, who is only 5'4" tall, and she was born in Massachusetts, attended Oak Grove School for Girls in Maine, graduated from Connecticut College, and studied law at Boston University. When she moved to New York City in the 50s, NBC hired her as a writer and commentator because of her legal background. She worked for the Today Show, then she performed off-Broadway, made her Broadway debut in Happy Hunting with Ethel Merman, and she was off and running.
Off and running.
Off and running, garnering 4 Tony nominations, along with your brilliant acting in Bonnie and Clyde, where you got an Oscar. I don't know where to stop or start.
You'll be here all day.
Because you played Roseanne's TV mother
for
years and years of all kinds of theater work you did.
Yeah.
But I think the great thing is you were inducted in 2004 into the American Theater Hall of Fame.
Yeah, that was the best thing.
Was it good?
I really liked that.
What did it mean to you?
I don't know. It was like a stamp of approval, right, in the theater, you know?
Well, it's funny because Carol Channing also got some award like that, and she said, well, I put in 50 years.
Right.
I should have gotten something for it.
Right.
So was it kind of like the Oscar?
Well, better for me, because, you know, I'm really devoted to the theater. I never moved out of New York. But the reason I was surprised to get it was that I do a lot of crazy stuff, you know, off-Broadway and experimental and all that. So I haven't had kind of a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 career. You know, I do this, then I stop and do that, and so... But it's nice to think that people know I'm around and doing things.
I was just going to say, it proves that you are... a person of the theater, that they gave it to someone who really belongs in the Hall of Fame. Because how many people, most people are like in this little box, right?
Yeah.
Well, did it change your life?
Directed. What? No,
getting that Hall of Fame thing or getting the Oscar?
No, no. No, nothing seems to change my life. Just goes on the same. I haven't been devoted to a career, you might say, consciously devoted to a career, so.
That's really interesting, because you've done so much, but you haven't focused on being a careerist.
No, I've been devoted to my life. I do whatever I want to do when it comes along, and, you know, sometimes it's acting, sometimes it's not.
Well, the thing that I thought was fabulous is when you started your career, or when you started, you were singing with a band before you were acting.
Oh, yeah. Music was my thing. I played classical piano. I started at 4.
You did?
Yeah.
Was it in your family?
Everybody in my family is musical. And, you know, the terrible thing is they can all play by ear and I cannot. That's how I turned out to be a classical pianist, because I can't play by ear and they were all sitting down, you know.
But where did the singing voice come from?
Well, I always wanted to do that. That was what I thought I would do. I wanted to be in musicals. I wanted to be Ethel Merman. It took me many years to realize Even after I'd worked with her, it took me many years to realize I wasn't Ethel Merman and was never going to be, that I'm a different person.
How was it working with her then?
Oh, she's wonderful.
Was it great?
I loved her. Yeah, I really loved her. And I saw her after, you know, after I had won the Academy Award, she was so excited. And,
oh, isn't that nice?
She was a terrific human being.
That's so nice. You wanted to sing, and you were in musicals on stage. You were in, like, Three Penny Opera.
Yeah.
And
I did the American premiere of Brecht and Weill's Mahagoni, the opera.
Oh, right, Mahagoni. The Rise and Fall, yeah. Pirates of Penzance?
Yes, I did that with Linda Ronstadt and Kevin Kline on Broadway.
You know what? I saw that.
I forgot about that.
I saw that.
Listen, you know, people didn't know it was me. I had these long gray braids. And somebody wrote in and said, you said Estelle Parsons was going to be in this show, and she wasn't. And that's because I was into my character.
You were into it, but we were thinking of Kevin Kline. I forgot he did that with Linda.
Yeah, Pirate King. He was great.
Don't you? I love Gilbert
performer.
And Sullivan. Anyway.
Oh, yeah.
And they closed that. Whatever that was in London, the Gilbert and Sullivan Foundation.
Oh, the doily cart?
Yeah, the doily cart.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, I saw that when I was a little kid, and they were touring this country and came to Boston. Because, of course, in high school, my sister was doing those things.
Well, every high school did that. We did it at Westlake, too.
Yes.
So it was great.
Yeah.
You spent... Besides that, several years at the Actor's Studio.
Oh,
as the artistic director.
Well, I'm still a member. I was artistic director for 5 years, but
what
I've been
is
a member
that?
Since the 60s.
You've been a member
the
forever,
Actor's Studio is like a gym for professional actors. It was started by Elia Kazan and Bobby Lewis, who were the top New York directors at the time. And they got the very best young talent in New York, Julie Harris and Steve Hill and all kinds of wonderful people, and started this kind of gym for professionals.
Was it like a theater company?
No,
it wasn't.
You know, everybody was working commercially at that time. Like, I would go from Broadway show to Broadway show to Broadway show. They'd run 2 or 3 months, you'd move on to another one. So I had several years like that before Broadway completely changed. So it was for people who were doing all this American commercial stuff to really expand themselves in these sessions where they do whatever they wanted. Shakespeare,
to dig deeper.
I did Medea there, I did Chekhov there.
I did
all the things that nobody was hiring us for in those days commercially. Before the rise of the regional theater. Now there are much more opportunities to do really wonderful classical material. Not a lot of them, but I mean,
but you needed
more than there
that were. Classical to balance you out, I guess.
8 shows a week of commercial stuff is
so you needed something
kind of a heavy,
for your brain.
Exactly, and that's what it was for.
But as artistic director, were you choosing the material? What were you doing?
Oh, no. What we have and always have had, once you pass auditions and become a member, then you're a member for life, and there are no dues. We raise money through, you know, functions and things. There are no dues. And now we get money through Jim Lipton's Bravo series
that was great.
So successful. Yeah.
Right.
But we have 2 sessions a week for actors, 2 hours on Tuesday, 2 hours on Friday. And you can do anything you want. You sign up for one of those hours, and you can do absolutely anything you want.
And you do it in front of your peers.
Yes.
No one else
and
can come in.
And then it's critiqued. Yeah. Then it's critiqued by the other members.
Who are your peers?
Yeah.
And
Lee Strasberg ran it for many years. He did the moderating, and he was a genius at seeing what actors were doing. I mean, he just seemed to understand what actors are doing when they're doing it, which is not usual. I mean, it took me a long time to learn to really see what an actor was up to.
When you mention the word audition, I know you're in August, Osage County.
I am in it.
You are in it. You're playing Violet.
Yeah.
And I think the great story is how it happened and that you actually went in and auditioned.
Yeah.
And people know your work, but you auditioned. Tell us how this role came about.
Well, Rondi Reed, who was in it, is a friend. I've worked with her at Steppenwolf, and Laurie Metcalf I worked with at Roseanne. So we all went out together one night. Rondi and I went to see Laurie in November, the show she was doing on Broadway. And we all went out, and they said, hey, Deanna's leaving. Why don't you do August Osage County? We always thought of you in that part. And I said... You thought of me in that part. I'm about as fit as a person could be. I don't smoke. I don't drink. I don't take drugs. I don't even take aspirin. So why people think I'm so perfect for that part, I'll never know. But anyway, I thought about it a few days, and then I thought, oh, I used to be on Broadway all the time. Why not go back and be there again, particularly in a play that's such an enormous hit.
Yeah, it was great. And so, she won the
She won the Tony. Right. They won 5 Tonys with it, yeah.
Right.
And he won the Pulitzer with it.
Right, that was Tracy Letts, right?
Tracy Letts, yeah. So I read it, and I thought, oh, well, I don't know.
Had you seen Rhonda in it? Rhonda and
Oh, yeah.
You had seen her,
Rhonda,
so you knew.
Yeah, Rhonda and
then
Anna.
You read it?
Yeah, and I didn't know. And then I didn't know the director. They said, come in and meet the director. And I said, yeah, and I would like to read for her because I would like to see if I'm really interested in the material or not. Because the material in that classic dining room scene, what she has to do is so bizarre. And I just thought, I don't know how I feel about this. Let me do it out loud and see what happens.
But see, that's the brilliance of an actor who still thinks she should audition. Somebody was saying something to me the other day, and she says, I was supposed to have that role, but they know my work. I didn't want to go audition for it.
Yeah.
And I was thinking of you, who's been on Broadway and done all this, and you still went to audition.
Well, you know, I think because I've directed a little.
That makes a difference?
That I think that my first husband used to say that I was certifiably crazy because I liked to audition. But for
me, you like to audition.
Yeah, because for me, every opportunity to act in front of people is an opportunity to act. I don't care what you call it, audition, performance, whatever. It's in a rehearsal. It's an opportunity to act. So I've always relished any opportunity I could get to act. I'm not much good at acting at parties or singing at parties. But I liked an opportunity to get up
to
there
the
and wail away at it.
And you are on the stage down at the Music Center in Los Angeles. You just came from San Francisco.
Mm-hmm. We started in Denver.
Oh, Denver's great. I love that theater complex.
Yeah, we were there 3 weeks. Then we're in San Francisco 4 weeks. And we'll be out for 10 months. 21 cities.
You mean on tour?
Yeah, yeah.
We call that
around
out.
The country.
You did it on Broadway first.
Oh, that's what I said, out. You didn't. I know. Yeah, we'll be on tour.
And then how did you feel about being on tour?
Well, I wanted to go. The minute they said they'd have a tour, I said, I want to do that.
Why?
Because I like to get around. I have friends all over the country.
It's not disruptive to your life?
Well, my children are grown up, and I never could do it when I had responsibilities there. In fact, for both sets of kids that I had, which I had 2 sets, I had to stop working. Like when the twins were in high school, I thought, somebody better be home here, even though they didn't care about my being home.
I'm the mother.
Yeah, and then my boy, when he was very small, and we found out he was learning disabled, in the process of really getting his life on track.
So you had to work
with stopped that. Working for a couple of years then, so...
So, but I was thinking that someone like you goes into a new city, but you know a lot of people, but what do you do on your downtime?
Oh, sleep, sit around, exercise.
You're not bored?
I don't have time to be bored. I pay my bills. I exercise every day.
We know you do that because the big question that's rumbling through everybody's mind from the Amundsen Theater is, how does she go up and down those stairs?
No. Tough.
Is it
very tough? Yeah, it was in the beginning.
But you know, when
it's
we saw
anymore,
it, I saw
but...
it the second time. I saw it with you on Broadway, but I thought you went up 2 flights of stairs. So I was going like, oh, she's only going up 1 flight of stairs. But you do, you run
at
up those
stairs.
At
the end, I do the two,
you
but
do,
no, it's
right.
Just 1 flight up and down, yeah.
But you come down holding both sides.
I put a lot of weight in my arms coming down because, you know, I'm supposed to be drugged out beyond belief, and he says, come down here. And I think, how am I going to get down those stairs? So I thought, I'm going to fly down. I'm drugged. Why not fly down?
So that's the, so you hang on and you kind of skid, kind of skid down.
Yeah.
But you still, you get mad and you run up. How do you keep in shape besides what you said? I don't know what you
said.
Well,
I do, I work out with weights. At least
do you bring them with you, or do you go to the gym?
No, I go to a gym wherever I go.
Do
I
you?
Work
How
out
do you
with
find
weights,
it?
And I do a lot of leg. I do the leg press, you know, single leg,
so
double
So you know
leg.
What you have to do.
I do a lot of leg strengthening stuff, or I did in the beginning. Now it doesn't matter, and I'm back to running now. I was doing a lot of swimming on the days I didn't do my weights work. And I do the bicycle a lot, which is very good to keep your legs strong.
You were Roseanne's mother.
Yep.
Besides the mother of your twins and your son, you were Roseanne's mother.
Yep.
And that was in front of a live audience.
Yeah.
Is it the same as
No. Well, they have warm up. They have signs, applaud, laugh. You know, it's a, and
so
the
you
cameras
have to,
are in the way, so it's not the same.
You have to make your audience laugh or cry, not the signs.
Yeah.
That's what happens then.
Yeah, it's much trickier and much more difficult. You have to have a lot of skills, which I was born with, to work in the theater, and I'm very proud of those skills, and I love using them because...
What about from city to city? Do you find the audience is different? I mean, you found the TV audience different, and now you find, how are
and
they
the
different?
The theaters are different, you know, so you get different feedback. But
that's what
all,
I wondered.
All the audiences are very dynamic, but for instance, in San Francisco, they laughed longer than in New York and Denver. They seem to be less interested in listening and more interested in laughing, which I found odd for San Francisco because I always thought they were a fantastic audience.
Yeah.
But we were in a commercial theater, and they have so much regional theater out there, and they have like 26 theater companies that I'm not sure we had a theater audience. I'm not sure it wasn't people who are just very attracted to this play.
That's really interesting because San Francisco puts themselves up with such great snobbery and such great arrogance.
It's changed, though.
That's interesting. And New York, they listen to the words.
New York, of course. There's a reason New York is the theater capital of the country, because it's a great confluence of brains and emotional responses. And they're just wonderful theater audiences. I mean, they are really the best, I would think. But Los Angeles
has
a lot of transplanted New Yorkers.
Oh, you think that's why we're such a good audience?
Yeah.
Oh, you're taking the credit. But I think that we're interested in going to the theater. When we go.
Yeah, right.
We go not just because we're on a series or something like that.
Yeah.
And you look at the audiences, and they're so diverse. That night we went, you know, physically diverse.
Yeah.
They looked so different. You wonder, like, what is this person doing here to see Violet, this drugged out lady? So,
with this play, they're very young and they're very old, you know, the
that's
people
what I mean.
And
it's,
all classes.
That's
too.
What I meant.
Yeah.
So, where do you go from here?
We go, we're 6 weeks here. This is our longest stop. And then
which
we
is
go.
Great. We're so happy to have you in LA.
Oh, it's wonderful, wonderful.
Don't
wonderful
you love one. It here?
Yeah.
And have you been to Disney Hall and to all
the cathedral?
And
oh, yeah.
Do you get to go to museums and different things like
well,
that?
Well, this time I won't because I'm too busy, but of course
you're too busy, 6 weeks?
I've spent a large part of my life here working, so I know the museums well, and I know the beaches well. I know the mountains well. I've climbed Strawberry Peak and San Jacinto. And
you stay at the beach. Is that a preference on your part?
Yeah, I always live in Malibu, but this time I'm in Santa Monica.
But why
Malibu's
is it? Just to
away.
See the water or?
Well, I found that if I can get closer to nature, I'm happier here. I just feel if I'm at the Beverly Hills Hotel where I lived a long time, and now I live at the Sunset Marquee a lot, but I just find that if I'm at the beach or in the mountains, either one, I feel better.
Before we leave, tell me what you bring with you. What do you carry around?
Oh, gosh. You know, I'm
actresses or actors bring certain things with them all the time?
Well, I don't know, because this is the first really big tour I've done, but I've packed 45 times more than I need.
Oh, you mean clothes-wise?
Yeah. And
but what about relics and things like that? Do you bring those things?
No.
Oh, that's good.
No, I have a nice picture of my husband. I have a picture of my son and getting married and graduating and a couple things like that. But no, I'm trying to travel lighter and lighter, but... I'm just a mess at it.
Do you shop? Do you buy a lot?
No, because I don't want to take it to the next city. It's a really good way to stop shopping.
That's true, too, isn't it?
It's really great if you have your suitcases full. Every time you see something, you think, oh, I'll get that. And I say, no, I won't get that. I'm traveling.
You have good discipline.
Yeah. That's great, because I know I got to pack up those darn bags.
Well, the reason when I started this interview by saying you were 5'4" is because you're such a larger-than-life person. And when people see you, they expect to see something like this monster woman, and you're like this petite, wonderful person.
Oh, gosh.
Little pixie. So anyway, I want to thank you for coming on today.
Oh, I'm so happy to be here, Joan.
And I'm just delighted to have you in L.A. at the Music Center for so long at the Amundsen Theater. Thanks, Estelle.
Thank you.
And thank you. Keep writing to my email, jaquinn1@aol.com and 777 South Figueroa, Los Angeles 90017. See you next time. Bye.